Okay, today, yeah, we will cover the principal component analysis. And I was able to find a note from one big data and machine learning class student at one of the Ivy League schools, and I found this note, which classifies the subject that and the tools which was covered in that course. And here, the in addition to the enforced learning, then there was a category of supervised learning and unsupervised learning. And here, supervised learning was classified as for the continuous case and the categorized case. In this case, for the continuous case of the supervised learning, then regression technique was used, such as linear regressions and least absolute shrinkage and selection operator and principal component analysis and 3D splines and smoothing techniques and variable selections and models. And for the categorized case in here, for these data, the classification was the tool to attack, it included the support vector machines and ensemble techniques and LDA, QDD, and naive Bayesian analysis, etc. For the unsupervised learning case, here when the data was continuous, then dimension reduction technique should be used, and for the categorized data, the cluster analysis is the tool to attack. So these are the things that we will see at the end of after the midterm examinations. So today we will cover the principal component analysis, and then next week we will cover the graph theory, and then I think we will get ready for the big data and machine learnings, which include the cluster analysis, pattern classifications, and data minings, and computational tools, and etc. Mm-hmm. Okay, here, the principal component analysis. PCA is a tool for finding patterns in high-dimensional data, such as images. And machine learning practitioners use the PCA to process data for their neural network, and PCA prioritizes the dimensionality that allows you to drop some low variance dimensions. And can improve the neural network's conversion speed and the overall quality of result. So you can compute and visualize and analyze the data effectively. Okay. So to get PCA, we are going to define some terminologies from the statistics, such as mean, standard deviation, and variance and covariance. Okay, principal component analysis is the most widely used and well known of the standard multivariate method, which was invented by Pearson and Hotelling, and first applied in ecology by Goddard in 1954 under the name factor analysis. So principal factor analysis is another name of principal component analysis. Okay, the purpose of principal component analysis is to identify patterns in data and understand the variance, covariance structure of the data. Okay. And we will study the mathematics behind the PCA today. Mm-hmm. It will help you to understand better you can find the many interesting lectures on principal component analysis from YouTube, and also there are many the lecture note and PDF files which and it's through the web here, and I will use some of those materials in today's lecture. Okay, PCA takes the data matrix. Actually, in this semester, our math department are offering an independent course on the principal component analysis. It's a whole semester course. But yeah, in our class, yeah, we will give a brief introduction of PCA so you can have a better understanding to start the big data content. Okay, anyway, the PCA takes a data matrix of n objects by p variables, which may be correlated, and summarize it by uncorrelated axis, which is called the principal component or k-principal axis. Here, the first k-component displays as much as possible the variation among objects. Okay. So, this is the key ideas. So, in order to find the first k principal axis or principal component, data reduction technique were used, and this data reduction is the summarization of data with many p variables by a smaller set of k derived variables like this. If this is a data matrix of the size n by p, yeah, we are trying to have n by k, much smaller matrix of whose column is only k, which is much smaller than the size p here. But still, we want to have this matrix has as much as possible information that this large matrix A has. Okay, residual variation is information in A, in the original data matrix, that is not retained in X. The key idea is the balancing the act between the clarity of representation and ease of understanding, and also the size of the data. But also, we should be careful for the oversimplification, which can result the loss of important or relevant information. So we want to make it as small as possible, but still we want to have the size that has the most of the important information are still in there. Okay, so in order to do that, we need some terminologies from statistics. First, given a vector x, it's called for the x, the mean x bar of x is defined as this. It's just the mean of the each of the component. So this is x bar is a vector, and it's a kind of moderated. So it's called the average of the vector or mean of the given vector. Okay, and let x minus x bar like this. So x subtract this mean from the x bar is not a vector, it's a scalar. Okay, this mean is a scalar. So just x minus x bar is the this x minus x bar is defined as this. So subtract this mean from each component. This is called the centered data point. Centered data point or centroid, centered data point. And next is variance. So in order to measure the spread of the xi's around the mean, we define the sample variance, for short just variance, which is written as a variance of x like this, and as this. Thus, the square of each of terms and add all of them and divide by n minus 1. This variance of x is called just the variance of this vector. Next, covariance. Given two vectors, x and y, the sample covariance, for short, just the variance of x and y is given by this. Covariance of xy is defined as this. The centered data point and of x and y and product of it, so add all of them and divide by n minus 1 makes this scalar covariance of x, y. The covariance matrix defined as the d by d matrix whose ij entries are this covariances of each x, I, and y, i's. So the covariance matrix X is defined as this. Actually, this is the ij and entry of this matrix is a covariance of the ci and cj's, which can be written in this form. Okay, this is a matrix. So each component it looks like this for ci and cj's. Okay, so the P actually, the eigenvector of covariance matrix is a tool to solve the principal component, to deal with the component, principal component analysis. So to do so, the spectral decomposition and the dimension reduction using singular value decomposition, and these are used. And when you when we find the principal component, when we do principal component analysis, we do use the covariance method. So eventually, the dealing the PCA is the analysis of this covariance matrix with the knowledge that we have covered so far, including matrix decompositions. Okay, here. What's the geometric rationals of PCA? Usually objects are represented as a cloud of endpoints in a multi-dimensional space with an axis for each of the p variables. Then the centroid of point or the centered data point is defined by the mean of each variables, like what you saw here, there, x minus 6 bar. And the variance of each variable is the average squared derivation of its n variables around n values around the mean of that variables. So like what we defined, the variance is defined as this, like what I mentioned. And the degree to which the variables are linearly correlated is represented by their covariance. This is Cij, covariance of Ci and Cj, the vectors. Mm-hmm. And this, so the covariance matrix is a matrix whose Ij's entries are this. This is one example which has appeared in Motor Trend magazine in 1974. In this, a paper here deals with 11 variables describing and quantifying various aspects of 32 automobiles from the year 1973 to 1974. So they listed 32 automobiles, and they figured out the factors, 11 as variables, like mile per gallons, and the number of cylinders, and the horsepower, etc. And with those data, they used the method of principal component analysis to analyze these data to have a meaningful conclusion. So the idea was retain as much as possible of the variation present in the data set, and they transformed to a new set of variables which is called called the principal component, and which are uncorrelated and which are ordered so that the first few retain most of the variation present in all of the original variables. Since even though each car has the can be compared with many factors of here is 11 variables, but after some analysis we will find some of those factors are very important, and many of the others are just minor. So they found that, like what you saw here, and this is the map that we can find the data. Then we found a new axis to display it in the new principal axis, which helps us to understand the comparison, the effective comparison of these cars. And here, the eigen decomposition was used, and actually the singular value decomposition was used here. And so, actually, this is an example of the problem that was treated by the principal component analysis in 1974. So, let's start to explain the mathematics of principal component analysis. The first derivation of principal component. How we find the principal component and principal axis on the given data. Let's start with the vector x of p random variables. We have variables which form a vector. Then the form a covariance matrix whose ij's entry is the covariance between the i's and j's element of the vector x when I is not j, and the variance of the j's element of x when I is equal to j. So this covariance is a symmetric matrix. So it can be diagonalizable. And look for a few derived variables that preserve most of the information given by these variances and covariances. What is here, the size of this matrix is 1 by p by 1, p by 1, but we're going to find a few derived variable m. It's much smaller than the size of the original data, and but still preserve the most of the information of the original data by using the variance and covariance. That's the whole idea. So how we can derive those principal axes? Here is the step. Look for a linear function, this, of the element x having the maximum variance, where alpha 1 is a vector of p constant that maximizes this alpha 1 transpose times the matrix sigma and alpha 1, and subject to this. It's, the norm is equal to 1. Okay, here. First, from here we find alpha 1 first. Then, the next, we are looking for the alpha 2, in the following way. They look for a linear function alpha 2 transpose x uncorrelated with alpha 1 transpose x. So, alpha 1 and alpha 2 are not related, uncorrelated in this manner. Having maximum variance, maximize this for alpha 2, but add this one more condition. So alpha 1 and alpha 2 are uncorrelated. So with these two conditions, and we maximize this, and find alpha 2 that maximize this instead of 1, and we are equal to 2. So from here, we find alpha 2. Then we find alpha 3 in the same way, and alpha 4 and alpha k. So for so when we are looking for the linear function alpha k transpose x, uncorrelated with alpha 1 transpose x up to alpha k minus 1 transpose x having maximum variance. That is this. So we are looking for this uncorrelated with earlier alpha k's, and then the norm of alpha k is equal to 1. And solve this. Then we will find alpha 1, 2, alpha 2, and alpha k's. All together this, and we can write in one form, we can do all this at once with this. We can write all this at once like this. It's in a matrix form. Trace maximization problem. Just maximize the trace of this matrix, which is addition of eigenvalues, subject to V transpose V is equal to IP. This is orthogonality constraint like what you have here. If you find the V here, then actually That means you found all of those alpha i's. Okay, here. Okay, here. So now this is the problem of if you can find the solution for this, that will give you the principal axis automatically from these observations. So how it works? That A be a, let's see how it works. Let A be a symmetric matrix, and lambda is eigenvalues of A in the order. Then we have what? This is a problem. By adding the first m largest eigenvalues, is the same as the finding the trace of this, because it's a similar matrix. This matrix is similar to A, so trace of this is the same as trace of A, which is the addition of the eigenvalues, and subject to this matrix whose columns are also normal. And this comes from the theorem which was introduced in the most of standard matrix theory books. Actually, this comes from here. The theorem conclusion here in the from the matrix analysis by Charlie Johnson and Roger Horn and Charlie Johnson by Cambridge University Press, page 248. You will see this. Statement that says let lambda i's are eigenvalues of sigma in the order, then the case principal component is given by this gk, which is alpha k transpose x, when alpha k is an eigenvector of sigma corresponding to its case largest eigenvalue lambda k. If alpha k transpose alpha k is equal to 1, then variance of jk is equal to lambda k, where variance of jk denotes the variance of gk. So actually this gives us the tool for finding the principal axis that we are looking for, which is this. This is solved by this by technique of Lagrange multiplier. I handed over the one page of the Charlie Johnson's books, and which has the same problems on Lagrange multiplier. I expect some of you solve those that examples, the one problem, exercise problem in the first page. Here, to maximize alpha transpose sigma alpha 1 subject to this normalized vector alpha 1, the unit vector alpha 1, then use the technique of Lagrange multiplier. So we maximize this where lambda is a Lagrange multiplier. Then this implies what? This implies alpha sigma alpha 1 minus lambda alpha 1 is equal to 0, which means lambda is an eigenvalue. Okay. Well, okay. So here is lambda is the largest eigenvalue of sigma, and alpha 1 is the corresponding eigenvector. So variance of alpha 1 transpose x is going to be just the largest eigenvalue lambda 1, because of this lambda 1 here. Largest eigenvalue here. That which maximizes this. Is going to be the largest eigenvalue. To maximize the second one, subject to this, and the covariance are zero. So this each of these are uncorrelated with alpha transpose x. So covariance of this and this can be written here, and this gives all these. This implies. This alpha 1 and alpha 2 transpose is equal to 0. So maximize alpha 2, the same thing, same sense. For alpha 2, for finding alpha 2, alpha 2 transpose x, we do use the Lagrange multiplier. Then we will see this satisfies this, which is this, which gives us this pi is equal to 0, which means. This, which means this. So this is another eigenvalue. Lambda is once more an eigenvalue of sigma, and alpha 2 is the corresponding eigenvector. So assuming that sigma does not have repeated eigenvalues, so it's diagonalizable, and then lambda and also it's all different eigenvalues. So lambda 2 is the second largest eigenvalue. Lambda 2. of sigma and alpha 2 is the corresponding eigenvector. So we were looking with this algorithm, what we found was the largest eigenvalue and corresponding eigenvector, and second largest eigenvalue and corresponding eigenvector, etc. So in general, the case principal component of X is this and this, where lambda k is the case largest eigenvalue of sigma and alpha k is the corresponding eigenvector. Got it? So this is the mathematics that gives you this principal component. And the reason, the existence was proved here. So with this method, then we can find the first and second and up to k's principal component of X. Okay? Like this. By using the Lagrange multiplier. Okay, let's review the eigenvalues, eigenvectors. Let A be an n by a matrix, and there exists a non-zero eigenvector, non-zero vector X satisfies AX is equal to lambda X. Then lambda is called an eigenvalue, and X is the corresponding eigenvector. And if A is diagonalizable like this, then it will be much easier. Yeah, you know, for this matrix, lambda is eigenvalue, and if and only if lambda is the solution of the characteristic polynomial equation, and the system of linear equations has a non-trivial solutions, and these are all laws. So when we have a diagonalizable matrix, then we can do many things easier. The system, the algorithm can work. Okay, let's just have some example. The finding eigenvalues and eigenvectors. Suppose we have a 3x3 matrix like this, and finding the characteristic polynomial by this command. Then we have this characteristic polynomial. Then solve this. Or actually just finding the eigenvalues. Then we will have the eigenvalues minus 3 and 3. But this eigenvalue 3 has an algebraic multiplicity 2. And minus 3 has the corresponding eigenvector here, and eigenvalue 3 has the two linear independent eigenvectors here. This can be solved by just solving the linear system of equation by finding the echelon forms. And for the first one, we have the eigenvector here, and we have the X for the second eigenvalue 3. And we have two linear independent eigenvectors, this. And we can normalize it to be used. And actually here, all those can be found in all this. Here the eigenvalues, eigenvectors can be computed here at adjoint and determinant. And eigenvalue at the end. For section 4.7, for characteristic polynomial, this gives eigenvalues and eigenvectors here. For this matrix and right eigenvalue, define a matrix, then we will have the eigenvalues and algebraic multiplicities and corresponding eigenvectors. And here, for fifth degree, this is a 5x5 matrix, we have the eigenvalues, and we just find all together eigenvectors. Eigenvalues, find eigenvectors. Then we have eigenvalue here, and algebraic multiplicity is 1, and this is a corresponding eigenvector, and the second here. Okay. Anyway, that's what I did, and this is what I found. So if we do just make a copy of this and go there, then we can find these eigenvalues and corresponding eigenvectors for the 3x3 matrix. Okay. Anyway, so that's the review. And fundamental theorem of algebra. For any real matrix, a real coefficient polynomial with degree n, then this polynomial of degree n has exactly n root. on the complex plane. Okay. If n is large, then it's it is not easy to find the solution for this characteristic polynomial by hand, and also it may not easy to find the exact solution for that degree of polynomial of degree n. So we use the numerical method. So, for example, for the matrix A, the characteristic polynomial can be found with this command. Then we can just plot that characteristic polynomial. Then we can easily find the eigenvalues that pass through the x-axis here, like this. And we have learned the method of finding the largest eigenvalues by which is called the power method. And we will review power method, and we will develop, we will go one step further. So we will use the modified power method to find not only the first largest eigenvalue, but also the second largest and third largest, and so on up to the k-th largest eigenvalues and its corresponding eigenvectors. And QR factorizations are used in that process. Okay, here. Power method, the simplest iterative method for computing the dominating eigenvalue along with its eigenvector is the power method. Under the mild assumption that it finds the eigenvalues of A which has the largest absolute value and a corresponding eigenvector. Here, suppose A is diagonalizable, then A can be written as this. A is similar to a diagonal matrix whose diagonal entries are eigenvalues. Okay, so assume the dominant eigenvalue is a real number and its absolute value is strictly greater than all other eigenvalues. Then, assume that. And A is actually every non-negative, every positive matrix satisfies this condition. If A is diagonalizable, in particular A has n linearly independent eigenvectors. We assume that then A has n linear independent eigenvectors, xi's and eigenvalues in order of this. Okay? Then now we start with non-zero vector, any non-zero vector x, 0, then we use this method. It's because xk can be written in this way. If the absolute value of lambda I over lambda 1 is less than 1, then as k goes to infinity, this goes to zero quite fastly. So all this goes to zero. So eventually, this x to the k over the k power of lambda one converges to C1 X1. So this leads to one of the very important methods of finding the dominant eigenvalue and eigenvector, which is a power method. That's what we have learned. Okay, we have developed the power method algorithm, like what you saw, and this lecture was given in here, and you can take a look back here. And also the inverse power method algorithm, which is inverse iteration with shift method, also introduced here with this inverse matrix. And the power method was applied to this matrix in this inverse power method algorithm. And we also defined the Rayleigh quotient R of X of this. And this is actually, this Rayleigh quotient can be used finding the eigenvalues. Because when x is an eigenvector with respect to the eigenvalue lambda, then actually R of x itself is an eigenvalue. As you see here, if you multiply this R of x times as you see, this was drawn by AX is equal to lambda X and multiply x star on both x transpose on both sides and divide by x transpose x, and then what's left? Lambda is left. That was the eigenvalue. So this, for some non-zero vector x, this r of x is an eigenvalue. If the x is an eigenvector, then this r of x should be a corresponding eigenvalues. So this Rayleigh quotient, which you saw from the printout that I handed over, and this is important terminology that can be used in the process for finding the eigenvalues. So anyway, 자, now with those background, now we developed the algorithm of finding principal axis. First, suppose A has P distinct eigenvalues satisfying this. P distinct eigenvalues. And lambda 1 is semi-simple. If the projection of initial vector U0 onto the eigenspace associated with lambda 1 is non-zero, then UK generated by the above iteration converges to an eigenvector X1 of A associated with lambda 1, and this mu K converges to lambda 1. Here is the iteration. Begin with the starting basis of Rn. Okay? Then form a matrix V with this. And then multiply A and A square, A cube to generate Vk. Okay? As k goes infinity, we can obtain one eigenspace corresponding to the eigenvalue of the largest magnitude. Okay. Here, with this method, we can easily find the largest eigenvalue, actually, based on the power method. What's next? What about the second largest eigenvalue? How? What is your guess? What is your guess? So, we explained from here the with this starting basis, we form the matrix V, and the power method gives us the eigenvalues. Then we know that. So with that, let's try to adopt this for finding the second largest eigenvalues. Here is the algorithm: simultaneous iteration method for finding the first k largest eigenvalues and corresponding eigenvectors. Start with the any basis of Rn, and then build up a matrix V whose columns are these linear independent vectors. Then make a QR factorization. Then find from this matrix V, we find Q0. Then put Q0 here and multiply A on it. Let it be a matrix W. Then do the QR factorization of it. Then you will have a next Q. So you name it as a Q1. And then let it be Q1. Then multiply A here again. Then do the QR factorization once again. Then you will have a Q2. Then multiply A on Q2 and do the QR factorization once again. Then you will have Q3. So you will find the series of QIs powers. Then important thing is the columns of this QK will converge toward the basis of eigenvectors of A. So in here, if the matrix has n orthogonal eigenvectors QIs with the corresponding real eigenvalues lambda i's in the decreasing order in absolute, if the leading principles of matrix of product are non-singular, this Q transpose V are non-singular, then the columns of QK will converge toward a basis of eigenvectors of A. So eventually, with this algorithm, we will find the corresponding eigenvectors and the corresponding eigenvalues in the order from the lambda 1 to lambda k. So the eigen decomposition and QR factorizations gives us a whole idea for the principal component analysis. And this principal component analysis also is related with singular value decomposition. And the dimension reduction is related truncated singular value decomposition. And in order to do all this, we need to compute, actually. We need to run those algorithms in computer. So we need to compute those singular values. We need to do the singular value decomposition, actually, and we need to do QR factorizations, and so now we will see the examples of PCAs. Okay. Before we go, singular value we will explain the singular value decomposition and the relationship between singular value decomposition and principal component analysis. So we review the singular value decomposition. Okay, when we have an M by N real matrix, and we know there exists an orthogonal matrix U and orthogonal matrix V, such that U transpose AV is a matrix of this diagonal, generalized diagonal matrix like this, in this form. Here, the main diagonal entries of sigma, this sigma, is positive and listed in the monotonically decreasing order, and all others are zero block matrices. And this is this is a diagonal matrix, and all others are zero matrix, and we call these are the singular values of the matrix A, which is in the decreasing order. And also the lecture was given in lecture 7 of our class, and how to compute this. And equation one is called the singular value decomposition of A, and main diagonal entries of the matrix S is called the singular values of A, and the columns of A U are called the left singular vectors of A, and the columns of V are called the right singular vectors of A. The following theorem shows that matrix U and V are orthogonal matrix, diagonalizing AA transpose and A transpose A respectively. You see this here. The letter decomposition A is equal to U S V transpose, where this S is a singular, this is a singular value decomposition of A, where sigma is a positive diagonal entries of S, which means singular values. Then V transpose A transpose AV is a diagonal matrix. Because this is a symmetric matrix, so it's a diagonalizable. And the size of this matrix is N by N. So this similarity gives us a diagonal matrix of this, and whose sigma is a singular values of A. And U transpose A times A transpose U is a diagonal matrix of this, size N by N. Because A transpose A N by N matrix. And we proved this already, and you can easily see this. It is a diagonal matrix whose diagonal entries are this, and size is N by N, and this size is N by N, exactly. So you know. And the theorem that A is an N by N matrix and A is a non-singular matrix if and only if every singular values of A are non-zero. Now, that's definitely the determinant of A transpose is determinant of A square, so eigenvalues of this. Now, if it's A non-singular, then A transpose is a non-singular, which means the eigenvalues of A transpose are all non-zero. Okay, so singular values are non-zero. So if A is a non-singular matrix, then singular values are all non-zero. Theorem. Suppose sigma is a singular values of N by N matrix A, then the matrix A can be expressed as follow, like this. This is what we learned. This is the rank one decomposition of the matrix A, isn't it? With the singular values, and actually eigenvalues, and singular values, and the column vectors of U and column vectors of V. You can write the matrix A with this. Because this is a 1 by 1 matrix, and this is a linear combination of rank 1 matrices. So this is called the rank 1 decomposition. Important thing is next. We're going to consider the rank K decomposition, which is this. What is a truncated singular value decomposition? We learned that singular value decomposition for any matrix A can be written, so the matrix can be written in this form, with this, in the singular value decomposition. Then remember, this matrix is a diagonal matrix whose form is like this. Then, this is R by R matrix, and this all the singular values are non-zeros here. Key idea is the full length decomposition of A is just use instead of this U and V, we only use a part of U and part of V, only R columns of this matrix is m by n, so we only use R columns of U and R columns of V instead of all columns. Okay, so we just write A as if S is in this form, we only use this non-singular matrix sigma here, and then use its corresponding columns of U and corresponding columns of V to form this. We call this is a full column rank decomposition, because the rank of A was R, so this sigma is R by a non-singular matrix. So we call this is a full rank decomposition. If we choose only k largest singular values of the among these, then we can have the k rank decomposition. If you only choose the largest k singular values to form a k by k matrix of this, then we will have the k rank decomposition. Okay. First, R columns of U. Okay, here. So this is a rank K approximation, which can be called as a truncated singular value decomposition. We can find a K rank approximation, truncated singular value decomposition, to A by taking only the first K largest singular values. Okay, and the first K columns of U and V. Which means this. Yeah, we are looking if we make it, then that can be written in this way. This is same as finding the matrix W whose rank is less than K, and this difference is the least. Then this can be done in this way, and so we do those matrix U and first K columns and the first K largest singular values here. If you form this, then this can be written as AK. And this AK is a K rank approximation of the matrix A. Okay. The whole idea is, when we have a matrix, it has a singular values. Those parts that the eigenvalues are zero has not much of meaning for the original data matrix, so just delete it. But even after that, still the rank of the size of the matrix that we're gonna deal is big. But in most of the case, the many of the eigenvalues is less than one, and even very close to zeros, which doesn't have many effect on the original data matrix. So we can just delete those smaller eigenvalues, the singular values, away. Then we can have the matrix of size k by k. So this rank reduction is depend on those technique, which is depend on the singular values. First, K largest singular values. This is the ideas. The singular value decomposition and principal component analysis. This is a relationship. Now, this is a way of finding the singular, the principal axis, once again, but with the singular value decomposition. Let the data matrix X be your N by P matrix size, and N is the number of samples, and P is the number of variables. Let us assume that it is centered, and then the P by P covariance matrix sigma can be written in this way. This is a symmetric matrix. Okay. It is a symmetric matrix, so it can be diagonalized. So this sigma matrix can be written as this, with the diagonal matrix in between, where P is a matrix of eigenvectors, and each column is eigenvectors, and this lambda is a diagonal matrix with eigenvalues lambda I in the decreasing order on the main diagonals. Okay, here in this singular basic composition, these eigenvectors are called principal axes or principal directions of the data. So if we have a singular value decomposition, then column vectors of these V's are called the principal axes. Okay. From that observations. Let's see the geometrical meaning of this. Suppose we have a data, data like that. Then we have x-axis and y-axis. But in order to analyze this, we can think about new axis which still has the older information together, but much simpler. If we look at there, the distance is a lot big. If we use this new axis, these differences are not big, but still, it contains all the information. And also, it has better information. You can easily see the nature of this data set. So, we are looking for the new axis that makes computation easy, but contains all the important information together. So this new axis, y1, is called the principal axis, and the next axis, y2, is called the second principal axis. So here, the projection of the data on the principal axis, this y1 and y2, are called the principal component, and also called the PC scores. These projections is called PC scores. These can be seen as new transformed variables, and the j's principal component is given by j's column of xv. You remember this x, you will see this xv again. So this the coordinate of the i's data point in the new p's principal component space are given by the i's row of the matrix xv. This xv has this meaning. This xv is called the score matrix. What this matrix xv means. If we perform a singular value decomposition of the matrix X, then the X can be written in this way, in the singular value decomposition, where this S is a diagonal matrix of singular value SI. Okay? Singular values SIs. This is a singular value decomposition. The diagonal entries are singular values. From here, one can easily see this sigma can be written in this way. This sigma can be written in this way, with this. Mm-hmm. Meaning that the right singular vector V are principal directions, and the singular values are related to the eigenvalues of the covariance matrix. This covariance matrix, by via lambda I is equal to this. So principal components are given by this. Because if you multiply V on both sides, then V transpose and V is going to be an identity matrix. Because the column vectors of V are also normal. So this identity. So if you multiply V here, then XV is equal to US. Okay, this is the identity matrix. XV is equal to US. Here, we write this XV as a score matrix G. So when we have a matrix X, then do the singular value decomposition, then this X V with the matrix V is in the singular value decomposition, it gives us the most of the information for this principal directions and principal component. So that's why this core matrix is important. The reason is this. If X is equal to US V transpose, then the column of V are principal directions and axis. Columns of US are principal component. Okay? The singular values are related to the eigenvalues of a covariance matrix via this eigenvalue, this lambda I. Eigenvalues lambda I shows the variance of the respective principal components. So to reduce the dimensionality of the data from P to K, which is a lot smaller than P, then select K first column of U, and K by K upper left part of S. This makes it bigger, U, big, capital U. And their product UKSK is the required N by K matrix containing the first K principal component. Okay, this gives a dimension reduction. And fifth, further multiplying the first K principal principal components by the corresponding principal axis, then this XK matrix that has the original N by P size, but it is of lower rank, of rank K. So since we had a rank reduction, so this new matrix has a much lower rank. This matrix XK provides the reconstruction of the original data from the first K principal component. It has the lowest possible reconstruction error, like what you see here. So with those, the column vectors, which actually the principal axis, and then with those you can have a rank reduction like this. The important thing is, when you reduce this rank, you did reduce cleverly, that has a very small singular values. So which can be considered has a minor effect on the original data matrix. So now this matrix has a much lower rank, and so that helps all the next series of the computations and analysis and visualization. That's the whole idea of the PCAs. That's the mathematics to find the principal component. So now, strictly speaking, U is the N by M matrix size and V is the P by P matrix. However, N is much bigger than P, then the last N minus P columns of U will be dropping. The one should therefore use the economy size or scene size of singular value decomposition and return to U of N by P sizes. Actually, from this example of the principal axis, and we choose the optimal ones. And next thing is the finding the principal axis. In order to do so, we need to do the singular value decomposition. So for this 2x2 matrix, we define the matrix and then find the A transpose times A, then find the eigenvalue of A transpose A, and then find the singular values of it, and then find the corresponding eigenvector of it. That gives you this. This is what I found. When I defined it, if I found the eigenvalue of A transpose A, which is the singular value of A, and find the eigenvalues and corresponding eigenvectors. And from there, I normalized it, and then I defined the normalized eigenvectors, and then I defined the U and Vs, so actually singular value decomposition was made. So from the given matrix, we have the UVs and sigma all there. And this code shows what we do. So in general, computing the singular values of A and eigenvectors of A transpose A. Find it first. Finding the singular value is just finding the eigenvalue of A transpose A. And compute the eigenvectors of A transpose A, and then which was that. And then computing the matrix U, which is the columns of the right eigenvectors, then form a matrix with those column vectors, then computing the diagonal matrix with the singular values, then check whether that singular value decomposition was done right or not. If you just multiply U sigma and V transpose, then you can easily check
whether they are same or not. If it's done, then you have a right singularity composition, so you can go further to find the principal axis. Okay?
Okay, I think that shows it. Since time's up, so I will continue the histories and the background and application of PCA later. Any questions?